never had TV. My school clothes was always hand-me-downs. And we didn't have toys. Bikes and all these things were all hand-me-downs. But I never thought we were poor. So I'm very grateful that my parents raised me in a way that never felt ashamed or anything. But now that I look back, yes, I think we had very little thing. Santa Claus, I found out about Santa Claus when I was third grade. There was such a thing, Santa Claus? And that's where first my parents were able to afford a Christmas present. So it was great because I learned a value of money, and we were given a very little money every month between my sister and myself to share, and then we would plan very carefully how we're gonna allocate these money. So anyways, in our house, when there is a report card, we give the report card to my parents, and the first thing they ask is they look at it, make no comments, and they go, "What was this your best?" And if they ask that question, how am I gonna answer? Well, I could have done better. okay. Then next time you improve. So that's the type of family that I grew up in. So yes, I was not an Asian. Well, now it's the average. It's A for average, B for bad, C for curse. That's what my kids said. So and then, as she said, I graduated from BYU Provo with a linguistics degree, and I worked in WordPerfect back then. I don't know any of you know WordPerfect.
I know.
Yes. And as an editor. And then I moved on to a networking company called Novell, and I was in a business, Japan business development team. Okay, now, how many of you here have seen a TED Talk by Cary Green? Okay, great, then I'm gonna do this. Same thing, because it's so inspiring. So I need a volunteer. Can I have some volunteer? Okay, could you please? Yes, he raised his hand. Congratulations, you just won $100. Wow. Thank you.
That it?
Yes, that's it.
That was easy.
Was that great?
Yes.
So Cary was saying, when I said I need a volunteer, what did go in your mind?
Did you ask for?
Do I have to do something really embarrassing? Oh, I don't want to raise my hand. I don't know what's going on. All these different thoughts goes in your head, and all these negative things. I'm not really a volunteer person. I don't want to go in front of. So all these different thoughts going in our mind and prevents us from doing whatever we want to do. But if I had known, or if you had known the goal, say, you are getting $100 for free just by coming up, everyone would have lined up. Right? Because you don't have to think anything. You just know that doesn't need, and then we tend to do that. We tend to go for something that is very clear. And we don't have to think, we don't have to take risk, we don't have to think about, and then this was a very, very inspiring talk for me. And I thought all of you have seen it, so I was not gonna do it, but just in case you haven't seen it, I thought I'm gonna do the same thing that Cary did that inspired me a lot. Because this, yes.
I watched that show, but I didn't know who it was talking about.
Great. See? So he had a little advantage that by volunteering.
But I really didn't remember. She's heard talk until you gave it to me. And I remember.
Yes. So by that, taking that risk, this negative thought of ours, all these things that goes in our mind, sometimes it's really a hindrance to what we're trying to accomplish. But that doesn't mean we just go blind either, right? But so I hope today You can learn from some of my mistakes and data that I'm going to share with you. Okay, now. So this is our store attire, and that's our slogan. When the customer comes into our store, we go, have you had your daily dose of happiness?
Aww.
And then we give samples.
I need two because I'm not happy.
I'll pass it to you. Okay, so that's what we did. Customer loved it because, that's a catchy phrase. And then they like the taste. This is all natural, you know, no food additives. So we were out in the market having up to 4 stores. That was Christmas at the peak. We had Tongchong, Causeway Bay, Bangkok. We were up to 4 retail stores in Hong Kong. And wow, you know, pretty big? Mm-hmm. Yes. But, fail. Why? Why do you think we failed?
Expensive.
Too big, too fast.
Expensive. Too big, too fast.
Finding people to work
is all true. Anything else that you can think of? It takes time to build a good brand. Yes, definitely.
You send too many samples?
Well, that didn't hurt us too much, actually. The sample was a very fraction of our cost. We'll do the cost breakdown later, too. Anything else? Okay. So
retail's expensive here. It looks like you have a lot of retail space.
Yes. Mm. So, cash flow. We did not have positive cash flow. Meaning, just for example, to have a store set up like that, how much do you think it'll cost?
How many stores? 4 stores?
Yeah, so let's just talk about one store.
Just for decoration?
Just for decoration.
$20,000?
$10,000 to $20,000, depending on the size.
More than that.
Yeah, $20,000 US.
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 Yes.
$10,000 to $20,000 US.
Okay, so there is a lot of upfront cost. And you're doing the depreciation.
What about stock? Was that included in stock or not?
That did not include stock. So we have stock. We have renovation fees, store setup fee. And if you want to go big, then okay, so all these items, decoration items, you know, everything, personnel. And we need to hold stock, so we need a warehouse, office, all these things. Okay, we were in trouble with cash flow. I mean, we could have had other investor come in and add another, but was that really worth it or not? I was always contemplating, should I ask for another investor? But, and another big factor was, I did not have any retail experience. I did not have any retail experience. There's one thing I can tell is, if you want a retail experience, do not do it in Hong Kong. This was not the best, smartest place to start retail. But to compensate for that, I did find a mentor that has a massive retail experience. He is the head of, he's the City Super group here in Hong Kong. City Super owns Auntie Prima, that's an international clothing brand. And then City Super, that's in Shanghai too, China. So he became my mentor and he said, had guided me. He was actually willing to put in some money for me as well. But he was having, just as a side, multiple projects at the same time. So there was one other person and myself, who are Japanese, that started a retail business here in Hong Kong. And he's gone big too. But same, after a year, it went down because there was umbrella movement. Oh, suddenly the visitor from China stopped because they went and news people in Hong Kong do not welcome mainland Chinese people. So a lot of people we had targeted were mainland customers where they came here for as a tourist, and then they bought a lot of things back. And then there was a lot of people who were hurt during those time and could not continue because the assumption that you had made didn't quite come through. Now, so for him to preserve the other brand, he had to put in about $1.5 million US dollar for to the other company to preserve that, you know, retail shops too. But that's okay, and then the second and third is products. Why do I say products? So this is not bad. People loved it. But what I found out was Chinese people do not eat sweets on regular basis. Not like the United States, not like Australia, which was originated, this brand concept was originated in Australia. So the customer love our product, but not to a point that they're gonna buy it daily or on a consistent base to consume for themselves. They'll buy it as a gift. And another thing I say over here is implementation of the alternative plan. So there's this one dilemma that we all face. Should I stay on this business strategy for a while, or should I switch it now? When is the best time to forget what I have and go move on to a next one? How do we know that? How do we know that? If we know exactly the answer, I would be so happy. But I have to say, it comes with an experience. Without any knowledge, there is no 1+1=2 formula to answer this question, when do I stay and be patient with the current market and marketing strategy versus moving on to a completely different one. So I did not know. So what I had to do was I had to rely on my data. Which product does it sell the best? So in my store, what I found out is 80% of our sales was on this jelly beans, natural jelly beans. It wasn't chocolate, it wasn't marshmallow, it wasn't popcorn, it was jelly beans. So this sold 80%. This covered the 80% of our sales. And then so I was talking to my mentor and says, that's it. He said, oh, that sounds normal. He says, there is a thing called 7-to-3 rule in retail business. Mostly 30% of the products covers the other 70% of the sales market. But you do have to have that 70% to get that very popular, because you need to have selection, you need to have like, you need 100, but you actually need most of the product, certain products just generates the profit, okay? But the key was, so this 80% that is not selling as much, how am I gonna sell it? Is it gonna go waste? So these are all the struggles that I'm facing every day. Every time I look at the number, okay, this one is expiring in 6 months and I have certain stock. How am I gonna sell it? So we have to do a bundle. We have to do a you know, buy one, get one free, or we have to do, oh, this is a gift pack. You know, originally it's $500, but if you buy it as a gift pack, it's $350. You know, you have to be very, very creative to sell these things. Or, oh, if you buy this product, well, this is just as, you know, short-term sample time where you get to choose extra one to for free to make a gift pack, something like that. So it's, so that is, you have to come up with an experience. Now, this is hard to see, huh? I know, I couldn't make it any larger, but this is an obsolete. Okay, so there was actually a gross margin profit percentage that was here, but not. So this this is a real product that it went scrap because it did not give us enough margin. But it's a good thing. So, wild guess. How do you decide your price? What kind of profit margin are we looking for in a retail business? What do you think?
First cost times five.
Right.
Cost times five.
Times 10.
Times five. 40%.
General first cost times five. That's at least in the U.S. That's a general rule.
Okay. In Hong Kong, cost times five will not survive.
Mm-hmm. U.S. is times five.
10.
Times two. Times 10. Ten.
Say at least you need to have 82%.
Yeah.
So meaning the gross. Like in a retail, so like we're talking
100%,
almost.
Yeah,
almost 100%.
I'm talking like five times. If you buy it for $10, you sell for $50.
Right.
In the U.S., that's what that is.
Over here, it's the so if you have two.
The cost is 10, and then the price would be the price.
So, yes, if it's let's say it's $20.
$20
is the cost.
The cost.
You divide that 20 and by two, so times, yeah, times 8.2.
8.2%.
Wow.
Percent.
That's it?
Not percent. So
times 82.
So it's actually divided by 1.8.
Divided by
1.8. 0.18.
So if you had a product that was $20, you need to sell it for like 160. Your cost is 20, you need to sell it for 160 to get that profit margin.
Yeah.
Yeah. If she had bought a product for 20, she would sell it for 160.
160, yeah, 160.
Yeah.
So 160. Why? But this is in retail. So I'll give you, so this, okay, so this is a cost comparison, retail shop, wholesale, and online. This is like what we have experienced. So we have an online shop using a thing called Shopify. Shopify is an online platform where you can put your products in, and then you can do a, you know, it gives you already a template, and then that's, it's an easier, like online, you don't have to build your own website, but it has a monthly fee, $114, but we have to pay extra because we want to buy it. So it, actually the cost is 140 for us, but the basic cost is about 114. And then, this is credit card transaction, online credit card. So if we use Shopify, that's not the best platform to use in outside of United States, because the transaction fee is so much. Per transaction, they charge you $18 Hong Kong, and R2 is $28 only. So if you're selling jewelry, great. You know, if it's a $50 product, that's fine. That's nothing. But if we're selling something like our product, if every transaction is taking up half of our products, that doesn't make sense, right? So we actually, you really need to look into, so what we did was forget the credit card transaction on Shopify. We do PayPal. We do direct bank deposit. And we do, PayPal has a system where you can email and then they can do a credit card and transaction. So we'll send you a link so that you can pay on your credit card, but the percentage is a lot lower. So we needed to find all those things out. Now let's go from the fee. So retail shop, I cannot disclose the whole thing, but there is a minimum monthly fee. So the way Hong Kong works is minimum monthly fee or 15% of your sales, whichever is higher. That's how it works. So let's say I have a shop in Causeway Bay and 300 square feet. It depends on where you are, but we're looking maybe about 30,000, 40,000, a minimum, or 15% of your sales. 15% is average. You can negotiate. Some would say we want 60 because we don't know whether your brand does well or not. Or, you know. Wholesale here is as bad in a way. Actually, SOGO, City Super are the best to deal with because they do not ask for a very high shelf fee. What they do is they have a trial period of 1 week, 2 weeks, very short. In that 1 week, if you don't meet their target sales, you're out. So that's how that wholesale works. But for some places, they ask for a very, like Watson's, they ask for a very high shelf fee, consignment. It's all the stock, they will never carry a stock. If there is leftover, you're responsible for it. And then, but if your product sells enough, then usually they ask for 45% off. Sometimes the grocery, they could go up to 60%, which is crazy. Okay, but, okay, and then retail shop, our monthly setup fee for the credit card transaction and whatnot was 2.5 per transaction plus 542 fee every month. That's just the fixed fee. You have your card machine, you know, everything. So that was something that it was. Now, do you have any questions? Staff. Now, staff is a big cost in a retail shop. So let's say about Hong Kong, $55. It's actually on the cheaper side, okay? Minimum wage for Hong Kong is like really cheap, but no one in the retail pays minimum. And maybe you can start from 50 for non-experienced person, but, and then you have to pay commission, you have to do. So that is a very, very expensive one. Whereas wholesale, you don't need to, but if you want to promote your products, you need to send people as a promoter. Why don't you, because our brand is not well known yet, why don't you try our products? So even if you're not, you don't have to stop it, and initially you have to put in people to do it. Now, and utility, insurance, all these are add up. And then we talked about the fixture costs, anywhere from 10K to 50K a And logistics. I did not know logistics cost that much until I really got into that thing. Just to take our products from warehouse to our store on a weekly basis, it could go, you know, 76 Hong Kong, I mean, one time is maybe about 150 to 200. If I'm going to new territory, 250 Hong Kong. So about 76, and then wholesale too. They're not gonna hold stock. We have to send it to a wholesale designated area where central location. An online shop, we have to send it to individual house when they order. So you do have to have a minimum of how much for free shipping. Otherwise, but free shipping nowadays is the most attractive part for online shopper. If you're not doing the free shipping, I'm not gonna buy from you. That's, I think a lot of people have that attitude. So for a product like ours, it's actually not that cost effective. So you have to look at what you're selling to decide what kind of outlet that you want to use. So it's actually good if you're selling something that's more expensive, okay? And a customer support. If you want a designated customer assistant, you do need that, okay? Now, I'm not saying all these, okay, so there was a recent research, it's about a month ago that came out. They have taken 2.7 million people founded business between 2007 and 14. This is in the United States, okay? So what they did was, they went to IRS, they went to Census Department, and took these data, and they found out, okay, so I'm gonna read it here. Okay, so the team took at data around the 2.7 million people who founded business between 2007 and 14 and went on to hire at least one employee. Along with average entrepreneur age, they also learned those new ventures with the highest growth had an average founder of age 45. Now, does that come to you as a surprise? Do you think that's about what you thought, or is it older, is it younger?
Older.
Older.
They're older than what I expect. I thought the new venture should be for the younger people.
That's what I thought too.
But it's experience.
Right. That's what it says. So the research showed that if you had worked for some other company prior to starting a business, right, they're more likely to succeed. Why is that? So why am I taking this? Because I know as an entrepreneur, experience is everything. Experience is everything. So every single thing that we're facing, every single moment that we're, it's actually an experience that we're building. So he's saying that we're building a commodity of human venture capital, meaning you're building connections, you're building an idea of more like a experience teaches us what is really can lead us to a tangible success. Now, okay, so here it says, okay,
okay. I really like that too, because I think, like you said, a lot of times we think of entrepreneurs being young people, but these older people, really 45 is not that old, you know, they've had these careers and now they're wanting to do interesting things that they're really passionate about, and they probably have the resources and, like you said, the connections and things like do it.
So he said that there are some assumptions that they made. One is experience, one is the specific knowledge of that industry.
They also have like systems and practices, best practices. So when they go the new, their own business, they don't have to make everything up. They can just borrow what systems they've already been taught.
Right, right.
Built upon it.
Yeah. So I think, you know, young people or, you know, like I wasn't young when I started, but any experience as an entrepreneur is very important. And any another reason that he said was the team that you build are more likely, you know your own weaknesses. You know what kind of people you need in that team to be successful. Let's do this. So, the reality is the most successful business are incremental improvements on existing services or products, not necessarily revolutionary ideas. This is very important. I'm not disregarding the revolutionary idea. That is important. But based on those ideas, there's no way your first idea is going to hit the jackpot. We have to make minor changes. We have to improve. We have to improve our service, our products, and that is the key to our success. How do we improve it, though? Any idea? Do we improve it blindly?
Just ask your customers. Observe.
Yes, we have to listen to customer. What is the best way to listen to our customer?
Complaining.
Complaining. Any experience on complaining?
Yeah.
A lot.
How do you deal with a complaint?
Depends on our mindset. If we think it's a way to know what we can improve,
uh-huh,
then we can respond with very good. But if we thought, you know, kind of whining to request some more things from us, then we try to escape those kind of complaining and just negative response from that.
Right. So we take complaint as this is a great feedback. It's an opportunity for us to improve. That's very, very good. Any specific experience that anyone can share?
I think, I've been in different industries. Clients complain when they are not pleased with the product.
Mm-hmm.
That is the main thing. If you give them the best product with the best price, even you give them the lousiest service, they'll buy.
Right.
But if the product is no good, even you talk like heaven, still the business is going to fail.
Research has shown that if a person's not happy, they'll tell at least 5 people. If they're happy, they won't tell hardly anyone. So really, you know, you're working against this all the time because, you know, a lot of people, they're only write reviews up on
you know,
TripAdvisor and stuff like that if they're unhappy. A lot of them don't write unless if they're happy.
Right. You're right. So I have an experience. This lady called to office and said, I'm just not happy. Your chocolate melted. Chocolate
melts
at a certain temperature. But she, so what we found out is she had left a chocolate in her car for more than 5 hours and it melted and she's just not happy. And I go, okay. So my staff is great though. She listens very carefully. You know, our chocolate is very pure. You know, it melts on a certain level, you know, at a certain temperature. That's just given. But she continues, Well, I'll tell you what. Could you bring your product over to our store? And we'll take a look. And then, I think what it was really, she just is just angry about herself not taking that out and spending that money. She just didn't want to admit, I've just spent, you know, a couple hundred dollars.
She didn't want to accept it.
She just didn't want to accept it. Okay, so what we had to do was we gave her a very big, big discount to buy the second one, and we gave some extra that we, like, the expiry date was really close by. So, like, we'll give you this. You know, it's expiry date is close, but it's still okay that we'll give you this for, you know, free. And she was very happy to go back because she felt like, okay, she did not
lose
everything, right? And she did. So I think it's true. Customer needs to leave your place happy when you do it. And then I think revolutionary idea needs to come when we're facing problem, when we're dealing with customers. How do we deal with it?
Non-meltable chocolates.
No good, we tried. There is such a thing. So, now, how do we measure our success? There's different measurements that we can have. Financial success. Achieving purpose. Customer satisfaction. Teamwork. Am I getting the experience to get to the next step? These are all measurements of success. To me, if any of these lacks, it's not a true success. Why do I say that? There's people who are financially very successful, but the purpose was not really met. You could be happy. My purpose is to be just financially successful. It can go so far. Maybe when you're younger, you need money, but once you get to a certain point, you go, okay, what have I really achieved in our life other than money? I mean, and then on the other hand, there is some NGOs that really, they may not make a lot of financial, like, glory or whatever, but they are fulfilling, achieving the purpose, and they're self-reliant. So it's a very difficult measurement because there's not set, you know, diagram saying, okay, this percent of finance is successful. This is the purpose, or customer satisfaction, it's true. You cannot satisfy 100% all the customers. But you have to, but we need to work on it. And then teamwork is very, very important too. And whatever, but also at the same time, any of the failure we might think, we can achieve on this last one. Everything is an experience to the next step. I think no one can fail on this one.
Right.
No one. Okay. Famous quote from Thomas Edison. I have not failed. I've just found 10,000 ways that won't work. It is. You know, so to me, being an entrepreneur is a lot of failures too, but I would rather fail 10,000 times in a little increment than a big fall. But I thought the first fall was big, but it turned out it's not that big. I'm not, you know, I'm still here. So what have I gained so far by doing this business? I have definitely gained humility and perseverance. I'm a lot more open-minded, looking at things from a little further, like not narrow perspective. Tomorrow I need to do this. There are things that we need to do tomorrow in order for me to accomplish a bigger goal. That I've definitely gained my patience. Business friends and mentor. This is something that I couldn't have had. All the association with my friends and business mentors been a true treasure to me. Time management skill. I was not an organized person before, but I'm forced to be organized because 6 children, 3 business, church calling, seminary is actually a daily calling. But I'm very, very blessed that I don't have to sleep that much. I'm a very deep sleeper. I can go to sleep 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. Next day by 5:30, I'm like out in 1 minute, wake up. It's okay, but of course I cannot continue that every day, but I am actually blessed with that. Talent, sleep anywhere, anytime, you know.
That's pretty good.
That's great. And then I have definitely gained industry knowledge. Retail business in Hong Kong, I wouldn't say I know all the answers, but if you are thinking to start one, please come and talk to me. I can share all the experience that I have. I can introduce you a better credit card companies, you know, all these gateway, online gateways, yes. And negotiation skills, yes. So Hong Kong retail, we said it's very hard, but actually, I did not know you can bargain down to so, I mean, you can cut it in half sometime from what their original offer. 60% maybe. It's all, sometimes it's a bluff too. So that I found. Now, this is a principle that my father has taught me to be happy in life. You have one of the principles that be thankful, do your best, put oneself into other people's shoes, endure to the end. True happiness comes from making others happy. Now, when he said, do your best, what he meant was, if I did my work in 20 minutes today, could I do it in 19.59 seconds tomorrow? It's just a way that, are we improving? That's what he meant by do our best. So what's next for me? With all these, what am I doing now? So we found out from customer, okay, Chinese people are not that big on sweets. And then one other reason is there is definitely a trend that sugar is not that good for you, right? People are more health conscious. So we cannot, you know, deny that. So I said, but they do eat sweets. They do eat desserts on parties and events. Those are places that they would. Birthday parties, corporate parties, some events. So we're not doing a more customized product. We just did one with Mikimoto, which is a pearl company, very famous pearl company. Here at Packard, customized gifts for these events. And then party, dessert tables. And then now we have a discussion with a mainland Chinese partner, because in mainland China now, they didn't have a concept of party before. as a Western party. But now, where people are getting more, you know, affluent, they want to throw a nice birthday party for their children. That looks good, something new. So we're working on that too. And then I have one more project, which I cannot disclose yet because but hopefully next year, if I meet any of you, that I can give you a good report. That Happy Lab is progressing, that the failure was a good thing, that's an experience. And so that's where I'm at. But do you have any questions? I know you probably have all the businesses. Anything that you want to throw it out to for a discussion table? Yes, thank you.
Where do you sell your treats now?
So I have a store-in-store contract. So there are some stores, select shops, that carries your brand. So they have different brand in one store. So it's almost like an airport setting. You have different brands of stores in. So I do the store-in-store. I do pop-ups at, you know, Sogo's and malls and online, of course. But yes.
After how many years you've been enduring to whatever this experience brings to you, and at one moment you know that this can work, you do this for whatever future brings.
Okay, so maybe I'm not okay. Can you say that again, please?
Is there a point that really makes you believe that what you're experiencing, good or bad, will make something really survive in the future?
Okay, this is candy only in that retail form will not survive. So that is already out. No matter how much I think you struggle, I learn, I can do better, it's not gonna, it may work, but it's not worth the money investment. Because you have a limited, it will not work because we can sell candies in other forms and that's better. And actually because of the connection and whatnot, I'm starting to sell other healthy products from Japan, and we mix it on our own. So the product range has been changing. So the roasted soybean with dried fruits, these kind of mixture, we are selling more now. And customer speaks right away. The response, repeater rate is completely different. So all these products that the newer ones, they wanna buy again and again. Whereas this one was for more there were repeated customers, but more for gift. I'm buying it as a gift. But the ones that we are facing now is more like I'm consuming it myself. So that's the difference. Yes, I'm sorry. So, yeah.
Oh yeah. I just partly got your answer. Now you're working mostly with retailers, so you're not owning own shop.
No.
You're selling by other shops.
Yes. Yes.
So what is the percentage the shops are charging for you?
Okay. So they only charge me, so that there's a minimum or 15% return. So it's not actually bad at all. Because you're actually, in a way, you're renting a space, you know? And then there is a professional salespeople who loves to sell. I don't need to manage any of them because management of these shop staff was a nightmare. I would walk in and I find out, okay, your friend giving your friend free candies. You know, so it's really, yeah. So that is a better way for us to go, because we don't really need a whole big space to talk. Yes. Any other? Yes.
I'm just curious, why you need to work? It seems like you marry someone who can make money.
That's see, because that was my two separate. So I had another actually set of talking about that was if there was only female ladies, but so okay, there. Okay, my husband. If it wasn't for my husband, I would be doing this right. But I don't need to work. I did not need to work, and we had my husband has a great job. So when I had my sixth one, and it was about 3-4 years, and then so-called in Hong Kong, there is a lifestyle called Tai Tai lifestyle.
Tai Tai lifestyle. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which means you go for lunch, you go for yum cha, you go to a school function, you volunteer at this organization, that organization. It's not a bad lifestyle. It's great. But because of my upbringing, I thought, I need to do a little more. And I wanted to have an environment where my children can work. So actually my children knows back to back how to label a candy. I mean, I use my six children as free labor. Yes.
Child labor.
Yes, but it's not against the law because I'm the owner. So they are doing like, ah, oh, mom, again, they do not like candy anymore. No matter how.
That's why I
tried.
Why did you sell candy?
They, you know, first they were great. They loved it. They're like, I don't want to taste it because I always have new products. Can you taste this? Mom, you know I don't like chocolate anymore. It's your fault.
Yeah. You know. I have your daughter in my class.
Yeah.
I hate candies.
So that's what it is. But for me, I think being a LDS mother, female, sometimes there's a misconception. It limits you.
Right.
From doing something. It's completely the opposite. It gives you more opportunity to involve your children, to involve yourself. And I just feel like it's been a true challenge, but a blessing, because without the knowledge of the gospel and a perspective, I wouldn't have had this happy challenges. And then I'm very grateful for my husband, who supports me in every way financially. Okay, so that's it for me.